Most of what we know about the nature of stars comes from examining their spectra. So let's talk a little bit about how we can classify stars according to their spectra. When we look at the spectra of our sun, for example, there are noticeable absences of light or colors of light within the sun spectra. And this, of course, is caused by the presence of atoms subtracting light from the star as it passes through the star's atmosphere. So let's break that down a little bit and just kind of talk about the different components or the anatomy of a star's spectra. First of all, we have the star itself, which is shining very much like a black body. The star is hot enough and dense enough to produce what would otherwise be a fairly smooth Planck curve or black body curve. But the star has an atmosphere. So it's the presence of atoms in the atmosphere that intercept, or rather the electrons in those atoms are intercepting light at specific wavelengths as they emerge from the surface of the star. So this results in the absorption of those colors or those wavelengths from the resulting spectra, giving us the dips that you see here. Now, in some rare circumstances, there may be some portions of the star, or maybe there's a shell around the star that is superheated and gives off emission as a result. However, this is very rare in stars, and most stars' spectra look like this, the absorption spectra that you see here. As a matter of fact, this is not just an arbitrary spectra, this is the actual spectra of the star Vega. So we can see the telltale hydrogen alpha, beta, gamma, and delta lines. There's also some extra lines introduced by the Earth's atmosphere, since this was made by a telescope on the ground. And there's a couple of other lines present due to the presence of other elements in Vega's atmosphere. So how do we classify stars according to their spectra? Well, the story begins with Edward Pickering at Harvard College at the time, and he developed a method by which he could take the spectra of multiple stars simultaneously. These spectra were taken on photographic plates, these glass plates that we learned about earlier, and he asked his graduate students, who by the way were all men at the time, to come up with a classification system based upon their spectra. Well, the fellows didn't get it done, and Pickering, in frustration, finally said, "I bet my secretary could do a better job." So he asked Annie Jump Cannon, eventually came up with a way of classifying stars according to their spectra, but identifying that the pattern or the presence of certain spectral lines were the result of the star's temperature. So these stars were arranged in the following alphabet soup that you see here, O, B, A, F, G, K, M. And Annie Cannon didn't do the job all by herself. She had so much data to work with that she enlisted the help of other secretaries. So this was Pickering's harem, as it was known in the day. So Cannon's initial classification of stars by their spectra was due to temperature, from hottest to coolest. However, there's really a range of temperatures even in between the individual spectral classifications. So what we have instead is not O and B stars. We have O0 through O9, B0 through B9, A0 through A9, and so forth. So these are just some of those spectral types shown here. But as we've already seen, a more modern way is to characterize their spectra as a function of their intensity. You can still see the presence of, in this case, the hydrogen lines, the Balmer series of hydrogen. There's also some helium, as well as some sodium and even titanium oxide. So you notice that the M stars are cool enough that even molecules can form, producing, in this case, titanium oxide. So when we think about stars arranged by their color indices, we know that the lower the value, the hotter the surface temperature, and since the spectral type is also associated with surface temperature, we can represent them like you see here. So where does our sun fit into all this? Well, it turns out that it's a G2 spectral type star. It has a color index of 0.67 and a surface temperature of about 5,800 Kelvin. So it's a little bit cooler than a G star, but certainly not nearly so cool as a K-star. So if you're having difficulty remembering the order of the spectral types according to their temperatures, just remember this mnemonic, oh, be a fine girl or guy, kiss me. Now, if you're one of my students, I certainly hope this does not apply, but here's an alternative mnemonic, oh boy, an F grade kills me. Whichever way you want to think about it, this is a convenient way of remembering the spectral types from hottest to coolest.